Channel 17, proudly serving the Florida parishes.
I'm attorney Pat Dunn. Auto accidents are a part of life. I hope you never need an attorney, but if you do, the team at the Mack Law Firm is here to help. Don't be intimidated by large insurance companies who just want to make your problem go away. We are here to represent your rights and interests. Contact me today at TangiLawTeam.com and let's get to work.
The meeting to order for the policy committee of the whole agenda for September 28, 2020. Miss Cindy, I'd like to have a roll call.
Amazing.
Ms. Dominguez?
Present.
Mr. Westmoreland?
Present.
Mr. Moore? Ms. Abrams?
Here.
Mr. Teller? Ms. Richards? Mr. Duncan?
Here.
Ms. Simmons?
Here.
Let the record show that we do have a quorum, then we can continue. First item on the agenda, revisions, subsection A. Consider approval of the revisions to policy JCDA, Student Code of Conduct. Mr. Porter?
Yes, good afternoon, committee members.
Afternoon.
Thank you for this opportunity. This was one, I think, that was left off inadvertently from the last meeting. Okay, well, this is where our student assistance team will be for students who have continual minor infractions. These students will be recommended through the student assistance team process for an alternate placement if need be.
Do I hear a motion to approve?
I make a motion.
To approve.
I'll second.
Motion's been made and second. Do we have any discussion?
Yeah, question.
Mr. Duncan?
So, Mr. Porter, does this new section, does it designate between like the different age groups that this would come into play? Or is this just any student that has multiple interventions?
Yeah, it's any student at any level.
I couldn't hear you answer. Well,
yes, ma'am. It's any student at any grade level.
Have any other questions? Call for a vote.
I say yes for me, Miss Cindy.
Miss Lee.
I ask the record to reflect that Mr. Moore is now present, and we're going to go on to B. Consider approval of the revisions to policy GAIB, solicitations to staff members. Good afternoon, Mr. Jenko.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Steele, rest of the board members. What I'd like to do, Mr. Westmoreland, I know the last time we had a long agenda like this, every time I would say that this is a recommendation from forethought, we've reviewed it, the administration, and we sent it to Ms. Bass to review. So I'd just like to let everyone know one time tonight that we received these new policies from forethought and their changes. The administration has reviewed it. It was sent to Ms. Bass for her to review and sent back to us, and that's what we're reviewing now. That's what we're going over.
Okay.
That's okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Cindy, I do not have my computer with me, so I'll just be giving a thumbs up or a thumbs down.
Okay. Policy GAIB, solicitation to staff members. It's been expanded to include suggested guidelines for sales representatives wishing to present to staff. All of this is in accordance with statutory provisions and to supplement the provisions of board policy BE, school board ethics.
Make a motion to accept.
Motion's been made. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Simmons. Having discussion? Call for a vote.
Voting is open.
Mr. Moore, yes.
Yes, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section C, consider approval of the revisions to policy GAK, personnel records. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. This policy has some minor revisions to include information on the use of Social Security numbers, the statutory requirement of a 20-day time frame for release of personnel records requested by another school board, and a section on ancillary files for consideration.
Hear a motion to adopt?
I'll make the motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Simmons.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. We have any discussion on this? Call for a vote.
Yes, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is open. Yes by Ms. Abrams. Yes by Mr. Moore. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section D, consider approval of the revisions to policy GAMA, employee tobacco use. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Policy has been revised to include sections on communication of the policy and compliance and enforcement to our employees. Language regards compliance and enforcement is taken from the Louisiana Revised Statute 17:240.
Hear a motion to adopt?
Make a motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Dominguez.
Second.
Second by Mr. Duncan. We have any discussion? Call for the vote.
Yes, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams, yes. Mr. Moore, yes. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section E, consider approval of the revisions to policy GAMFA, employee communicable disease. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Some minor changes were made to this policy so that it would be in compliance with policy GAMFB, the guidelines for handling bodily fluids in a school, and to update the reference section.
Hear a motion to adopt?
I make the motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Simmons.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. We have any discussion?
So would you repeat that again? Are you're pulling this out, it's going into a different?
No, ma'am. The minor changes that were made, I believe it was last policy, we approved something called handling bodily fluids in school. This changes that were made to this one will reflect the changes that were made in that policy. So they go together.
Okay, yeah, because it's got quite a few paragraphs pulled out.
Yes,
yeah.
Deleting them about bodily fluids and all.
Just want to make sure it was covered somewhere else.
Can you speak up a little bit?
We wanted to pull some paragraphs out that we wanted to make sure we were in compliance with HIPAA or anything else that could be applicable because it is, you know, medical issues.
Okay.
Any further discussion? Call for the vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section F, consider approval of the revisions to policy GAMFC, health examinations. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Updated policy that expands the information on medical examinations specifically for our new employees. Although medical examinations are required for bus operators by statute, we have included the school board's right to require any employee to have a medical examination per there's evidence of such condition and when there is a concern for safety. And it's that first section that talks about under new employees, which was the added section.
So, have a motion.
I make a motion.
Motion by Ms. Abrams.
Second.
Question. Second by Mr. Duncan. We have any discussion?
Question.
Yes.
So, we're requiring maintenance, food service, and bus driver employees to present with their certificate. But we're, but that's it? We're not, no other category?
Correct. With the physical demands, we just want to make sure that a doctor says that that particular employee can meet their job description. Another effort for workers' comp, et cetera.
Okay.
Is that because of the type of work?
Yes, ma'am.
But it also allows the superintendent to require any employee.
Correct. Yes.
To submit if there's, I guess,
questions.
Reason. Any further discussion?
The only other one I would think of is coaches, but particularly the coaches that coach outdoors.
Yes.
But
so
would you like to add that, Mr.?
No, it's just a thought. For the superintendent to consider possibly.
Call for a vote.
Mr. Duncan.
Yes, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is open. Yes, Ms. Abrams. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section G, consider approval of the revisions to policy GAMFD, personal security and safety.
Mr. Jenkins. Thank you, sir. This policy is just being retitled from assault and battery on school personnel to personal security and safety. No other changes.
Move to adopt.
Motion by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. Any discussion? Call for a vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section H, consider approval of the revisions to policy GAMG, dangerous weapons. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. This expanded policy includes certain exceptions for ROTC, law enforcement or school resource officers, props for drama presentations or other exceptions as allowed by state law, such as constitutionally protected firearms stored entirely within a vehicle. The policy also requires employees to report another employee who possesses a firearm or other dangerous weapon to a supervisor or administrator.
Do you hear a motion to adopt?
Move to adopt.
Second.
Mr. Duncan, second by Ms. Simmons. We have discussion. Call for a vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section I, consider approval of the revisions to policy GAMI, use of telecommunication and other electronic devices. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Expanded policy includes suggested provisions addressing telecommunication and other electronic devices by employees. One of the big new sections is applies to employee provided cellular phones, or what is acceptable and what is not acceptable for their use.
Hear a motion to adopt?
I'll make the motion.
Motion by Ms. Simmons.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. Discussion.
Hang on just a minute.
Okay. Ms. Rose asked for a timeout.
Yes, sir.
I think this is the one I was going to ask. I just want to refresh my memory real quick.
Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead, Mr. Duncan.
What is the purpose of the last paragraph? Or why is that being recommended?
I don't know why it was included other than to protect y'all from the public had on their cell phone numbers, maybe?
Because we do publish the...
It's pretty much public record.
The home phones and information you choose.
Yeah, home phones. I don't publish cell phones.
It should be your published, though.
Pull it closer, Ashley.
There's no, that's, there's no law that says they can't contact you if you're okay with them contacting you. It's just, this is to protect you from, you know, having irate employees call you on your home phone at midnight.
Is there such thing as home phones now?
No. Some people have them, but, you know,
I think home phones today is interpreted cell phone.
Exactly.
So there's nothing to say they're not going to, but this is a, you know, policy for the employees that they contact you through the means that you want them to contact you through. And not by some, you know, somebody sent you your personal contact.
So basically they can only be contacted by the information we put out.
Correct.
So
there's no way to police it, you know, because they get it, they're going to do it, but you know, that way you have a policy in place if you want to enforce the policy.
So I read it to, I mean, the first sentence says that you got to use, if you're an employee, you got to use, I guess, your aren't publicized information to reach out to us. It also says that you can't block contact information, your contact information when you contact a school board member. And then the last sentence says that if a school board member provides other means of communication to an employee, then you can talk to, I mean, so it's very confusing because it says don't do it.
But then if you give them permission, it's okay.
Well, that's what I was saying is, we put this in here, when I read it was to protect you all so that they can only use the information you want out there, your contact information. Because some of you may have two cell phones, one for your family and friends and one for, you know, other people who happen to have it, like school board, you know, employees. So, but the last sentence, as I read it, would just mean that if you choose to give Sally Sue your personal cell phone number, then you can do that. It doesn't stop you from doing that. That's how I read it. But, you know, it's y'all's policy, so you can however you want.
I would like to hear some other board members, but, you know, I think we already get criticized enough, or we have employees that fear reaching out to us because they fear retribution for reaching out to us, which is a lot of times why they send things anonymously to us through fake email accounts and all of that stuff. I worry that putting in policy that you can get in trouble if you don't contact your school board member a certain way. I'm just uncomfortable with that, and it kind of feeds into, I think, an already unfair perception of the administration. Because I'm not aware of any instance where an employee has gotten in trouble for reaching out to me, at least, but I know that that's out there.
So maybe what about we keep the first sentence and the last sentence and get rid of everything in between?
There's no law that says you have to have it at all in there. It's the board's preference on how you want and the flow of information you want from the public and the employees.
Why don't you just put employees may contact school board members utilizing email account, mailing address, or phone numbers designated by us at the main office, and that nothing, like you said, the last sentence also.
Mr. Jacob, I'd like to insert something here. I think that leaving this in here, it does do exactly what Ashley is saying. It encourages people to follow the protocol, to not call us for something that they could, something that they could resolve if they just call the principal or if they just call their child's teacher, you know. And so maybe this doesn't Maybe this doesn't seem to be something that's necessary, but I don't see where it actually does anything to create a problem at the same time.
Yes.
You know, I mean, we're going to vote on it. I would vote to leave it in there.
Well, this is one of those things that it's totally the preference of the board members.
Your discretion.
Yeah, it's how you want information flowing in and out from you and how you want people to be able to contact you. So y'all can decide to leave it, to take it out, to change it. I guess my thing is, if there's no law either way, it's just preference of the board.
I guess we'll vote on it.
No proposed amendments, and then we'll just call for the vote.
Okay.
Did you have a question? I'm sorry. Hold on.
Well, the question I had was in a different policy, but okay. Just in contact, talking about what Brett said, these days, Facebook or other social media is almost 80% of the way I'm contacted these days.
That's exactly me, too. I don't accept friendship requests, but they do send private messages.
They send private messages, and I mean, I may or may not see it right away, which is the bad part, because they think, oh, she's not looking, she's not answering. I don't really look at Facebook Messenger like 5 times a day. I mean, I may see it. I happen to notice that there's someone sent me a message a day or two ago. So it's really to their hindrance if they use this, because we don't look at that Facebook, you know, every minute like some people do.
Mr. Jerry said
they really want an answer. They need to send. Exactly. If they really want an answer, they should email us at our true email address.
They still get in contact with you, right?
They have no problem getting in contact with
me. That's right.
So, I mean, you hate to tell people not to message you through Facebook, because we are, you know, some of us are on Facebook, some of us are not. But
about only, if we get rid of only.
That's okay. I mean, the last sentence is fine. If I want to put out there that, which I have, people know that they can reach me in all kinds of different ways. So, I mean, so
yeah, since we got a public law office, I mean.
Right. So,
yeah. All right, I'm calling for the vote.
So we're voting to approve this
yes.
policy.
Yes. As is.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section J, consider approval of the revisions to policy GAMIA, electronic communication between employees and students.
The policy has been expanded, and it includes a proposed paragraph to allow employee utilization of personal communication devices to relay information and assignments that may have previously been denied by the board per policy, provided they are an educational purpose and the communication is reported in a timely manner to the building administrator.
There a motion to adopt?
I'll make a motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Dominguez.
Need a second,
or it's going to die.
I'll make the second.
Second by Mr. Duncan.
But I have.
Go ahead.
So is this to mean that the teachers can text a student directly? Is that what we're trying to allow here?
Providing it is for an educational purpose. And when I read it, my thought was, first thing being text, that if I'm having trouble finding out what the lesson is and I'm having trouble getting to my on course, that they may be able to text, the teacher may be able to text, we're doing section 3.7, page 35 through 38 for tonight. But they would have to make sure they allow let their building administrator know that on August 15th at this time I text this person or this group of individuals and this was the information I text.
To me, wouldn't it be better to put something in there that requires that the supervisor, like that there always be two adults as part of any communication that goes directly to a student?
Okay.
I'm just...
I get what you're saying. Include, have it like a group text with the supervisor.
Yeah. I mean, I don't see any, I just see a lot of possible problems with having an adult be able to privately message a student on a non, like I know with our emails and with OnCourse, the administration or somebody can always go and look at that.
Correct.
And I think all of our employees know that that is not private communication. But if it's something from their own devices that is not, you know, one of our devices, that just creates a, I mean, I just think there ought to be a clear line that you don't get to privately communicate with your students outside of a school system account.
Yeah, one thing could lead to another.
Yeah, I mean, it just creates for...
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, maybe it should be if there's anything, a group text that includes the parent, maybe some other designated faculty member.
And this is probably the product of how school is right now.
Mm-hmm.
Why we have to have something that allows teachers to communicate with students because of our virtual stuff and all the COVID stuff. So, but I do think it's a good idea if you have a supervisor as part of the designee, as part of the group, because in this world we live in, it's safer for that.
That was my question earlier. In the past, we used to, if a teacher had to send an announcement to the class or a basketball coach or football coach, whatever, practice is canceled today, that kind of thing, but not for a conversation, more for announcements. And then instead of having to involve a supervisor and all of these teachers, it could be a co-teacher. It could be, you know, if you have two football coaches or whatever, but then you got to keep this record for a year. Who keeps text messages for a record for a year on their phone? I mean, I don't know. It's just kind of an unusual thing that we're doing here right now.
Well, if I wanted to forward something that you sent to me, to Miss Stilley, once I press the forward, I can change the wording in your text message and then forward it to her.
Yeah.
So I can say, look what Ron just sent me, and it's not really what you sent. And then you would have to go and subpoena records and subpoena phone logs to see what that text message actually said.
Yep. How about on that, in that last sentence, this would be the amendment that I would recommend. So that sentence that says the school board recognizes blah, blah, blah.
On page one.
And then it's on page one. It says, provided that the communications are for an educational purpose and the communication is simultaneously sent to the student's parents and or the employee's supervisor. Rather than timely reported to the building administrator, it would be that it has to be copied to either that student's parent and or the employee's direct supervisor.
Which sentence is that?
That's at the
last sentence of the green section.
Wait. Yes, the third paragraph.
The school
simultaneously
board shall permit.
What did you say?
Are you addressing that to text messaging?
It's any of
any electronic communication.
All communication.
Can we maybe? I feel like if we're going to have to keep a record of this, which we do, it needs to be to an employee, a co-employee, not just a parent. So if we want to send it to the parent, there's no reason we can't. Although I think it's better to make sure the other adult is an employee of the system.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than a parent.
Yeah,
I mean, exactly.
So instead of or, it would just be and.
Well,
but this only addresses communications from the employee's personal devices.
Yeah.
We're not talking about all the other types of communication. If they're sending a text or something from a private email that's not school system
approved.
Yeah, then you would, I think the parent or guardian, number one, needs to know, but then also the direct supervisor. But I know that
so then, but that would, but we will then have to ensure that that teacher has the parent's cell phone number. And if they don't, then
That would, if available. I'll include words if available, if the information's available.
If possible.
Yeah, if possible. But, so do you need me to restate it?
So I have, the school board shall permit its employees to use their own personal electronic communication devices for communications between the employee and employee students, provided the communications are for an educational purpose and the communication is copied to the student, parents, and the employee's immediate supervisor?
No.
No, okay.
So it would say, provided that the communications are for educational purposes and the communication is simultaneously sent to the student's parents, put in parentheses, if their contact information is available.
Which sentence are you beginning at? The second one or the first one?
This is at the end. We're striking the words, is timely reported to the building administrator.
Simultaneously.
Yeah. Okay.
So we're striking those words, is timely reported to the building administrator, and replacing that after the word and the communication, we're going to add, is simultaneously sent to the student's parents, if possible, in parentheses, and the employee's direct supervisor.
Okay. I will type this in.
Got it?
Yes.
Do I have a second to the proposed amendment?
Second.
We have a motion to amend this and a second. We need a vote on the amendment to allow the amendment.
Okay. Oh, okay.
We need a vote or we need to make a motion?
Wait, just one second.
A vote on the amendment to allow the amendment, and then we'll vote on it as amended.
Voting is open.
Yeah. Now you gotta.
Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Okay. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Now, do we have any further discussion on the policy as amended?
Well, I need to read the paragraph after that. We need to make sure that jives up with what we just did. Shall we report? So we need that second paragraph to provide for the same thing, that if it's communication that's other than school system related communication, or that rather than that 1 week, within 1 week,
mm-hmm.
It needs to be that simultaneous language that we just did.
Okay.
I mean, technically, we're encouraging our people not to text their students, group text would be better than, mm-hmm. You know, because that's why we have email and that's why they have on-course messaging and all that. We really don't want our people to text their students.
Should be a last resort,
but if they're having to report this every time they do it, maybe this will make them realize, well, maybe I don't need to do this because I have to report this every time I do it. Of course, we hope that they report this every time they do it.
If they don't, we'll find out.
Yeah, you're going to find out from parents that they got messages from their people. I mean, as we all know, text messaging is much easier sometimes. However, it's very important to be conscientious with our students.
So you want some amendment to that to take out?
No, I'm actually reading this again. What this is saying is that if anyone finds out that there was some sort of communication between an employee and a student that was not in accordance with that provision above, then they have an obligation to report it, right?
They have a 1 week to.
Yeah, so I think that's fine.
Okay.
So we don't need to change that one?
Well, yeah, because I don't think there's anything in that paragraph that contradicts what we just did,
so
now that I'm reading it.
We change it or we don't change it?
No changes.
Okay, I'm going to call for a vote on the policy as amended.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section K, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBA, contracts and compensation. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Only revision made to the policy was an update to a reference of one of the Louisiana revised statutes, 17:3881 through 3905.
Hear a motion to adopt?
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Ms. Abrams. We have any discussion? Call for the vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section L, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBAA. Compensation guidelines overtime. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Policy has been revised and is somewhat better organized and expanded to address new information included or definitions of full-time, part-time, temporary employees and the recording of overtime hours. And Ms. Cindy, the first paragraph, the green fair.
Page two.
First fair. Sorry, I didn't catch it earlier.
Fair.
Last sentence, Fair Labor,
Fair Labor Standards Act.
Oh, fire.
Move to adopt.
You're just checking to see if I was
motion to adopt by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez.
Thank you.
Any discussion?
Mr. Jenko.
Call for a vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section M, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBB, personnel positions. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Policy is updated in that last paragraph to talk about new positions, and then we'll come to you with a job description and the salary range for those new positions.
Your motion to adopt?
I'll make the motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Simmons. I hear a second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Duncan. Have any discussion?
It doesn't really say, but it still comes as full board for approval, right? I mean, in the past, we always...
Yes, ma'am. But that is one of the functions. If we have X number of teachers and we're going to add Y number of teachers, we've got to come to get approval for that as a function of the budget.
And also the job description.
Correct. The job description will be, you would get the teacher job description if it's a teacher job with the salary range.
Okay. Yeah.
Call for a vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section N, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBBA, qualifications and duties. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Just revises the qualifications and duties of our teachers and talks about other personnel, saying the superintendent shall ensure that other school employees, both current and prospective, have proper certification as applicable.
Hear a motion to adopt?
I make a motion.
Motion by Ms. Abrams. Hear a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. Any discussion?
I was just kind of curious about the paragraph you added kind of in the middle there, like there should be extensive supervision of students in the other areas like outdoor PE, chemistry and all that, but I mean, we should have be extensive welfare of all our students, whether they're in a classroom or in a lab. I don't know the reason why we're adding that. We should always watch all of our students diligently.
Correct.
I don't get that at all. You think, Mr. Duncan?
Yeah, I was reading that too, and I'm just trying, I was trying to figure out why we picked like tutoring, for example.
I mean, yeah.
Like some of the other ones, I don't know.
I mean, our standards always to act as reasonably prudent people anyway, and that's already in there. I don't know if that's imposing more liability on our school system than we already have by requiring, you know, lawyers. I'm just thinking about intensive supervision. What does that mean as compared to other supervision, you know?
What is the... What was the motivation for adding that? Was it due to incidents in classrooms or in some of these areas where someone thought there should have been more supervision that would have prevented it?
No, sir. The information was sent to us from our Forethought, the company that does the policies related to the statutes and so forth. So they added the language and. As we read through it, we did not take it out.
Okay, I would like to amend that myself. As part of the work assignment, teachers, comma, as well as other employees is fine and shall perform duties as necessary to reasonably maintain the safety and welfare of the students. And the next sentence is fine, but I don't know why we're adding that last sentence about
so from there
singling
to the
out.
There is no legal reason to add it.
The amendment is to delete that paragraph.
That last sentence.
Last sentence of
that last
paragraph.
Statement about all those activities. I think so that's totally unnecessary.
There and ended events.
Yeah. Yes. That's what I'm saying. Make a motion to remove that.
We have a motion to amend the policy. Do I have a second?
A second.
Second by Ms. Abrams.
Which sentence are we striking?
The very last one that says there shall be intensive supervision.
All right, that whole sentence.
Yes.
The whole
okay.
sentence.
Yes. We have a motion to amend and a second, so we have to have a vote on the amendment to allow the amendment.
Okay. Ms. Dominguez. Ms. Abrams. Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously. So this is a...
All right, do we have any further discussion on the policy as amended? I think we're ready for the vote.
So we're voting now to strike the third sentence in the third...
No, we did that with the amendment.
Okay.
The amendment struck it. Now we're voting on the policy as amended.
Okay. Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section O, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBG, probation. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Revised policy shows the superintendent's authority to dismiss school employees, basically talking about during their probationary period, and that the employee does not have a, or is not entitled to a hearing before the board.
Hear a motion to adopt?
So moved.
Motion
second.
By Mr. Duncan, second by Ms. Simmons. Do we have any discussion?
Is this employees or is this administrators as well?
No, this is employees. You know, that for administrators, there are provisions in the contract that we would have to follow until that individual gets his or her second contract.
Any further discussion? Call for a vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section P, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBI, evaluation. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. It's just a minor revision where it adds a new statutory reference, which is Louisiana Revised Statute 17:3883.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any discussion? Call for a vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes. I didn't realize I can vote on my phone. It just popped up.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Okay. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section Q, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBJ, promotion.
The policy adds a section and language that an employee under investigation, suspension, probation, or any other adverse personnel action shall not be considered for promotion until a satisfactory conclusion of the matter has been resolved.
Make a motion to accept.
Motion by Mr. Mingus.
Second
by Mr. Duncan. Mr. Duncan, go ahead.
So, Mr. Jenko, I'm trying to give me an example of one of our types of employees that could get like an administrative type of promotion that under this scenario.
Maybe if I was a teacher that had applied for an assistant principal position and for some reason I was had a felony charge against me.
Okay. But that's still an application. I'm trying to think, I mean, all of those are application. Like that's, you know, we have a position that opens up, you apply, you go through the process. But this seems to refer to like a situation where somebody's just being promoted from within. That's not an application type process. Like, do we have something like that that exists?
No, sir. I mean, you have...
Like in maintenance, do we have, like, can you go from...
No, all of our positions, and we've been very clear, we're advertising for all of our positions that would be a step up in pay, a promotion type thing, we advertise for those.
But it would make them ineligible to even apply, right?
Until if this is...
Unless they were clear.
Rectified, correct.
What if it was... The only thing I could think of that would be that, like, what if they had applied for the position... And we're going to receive it, you know, maybe didn't start for 6 months and receive it. And then during that time, they were under some kind of investigations. The only thing I could think of off the top of my head that maybe that would apply.
I mean, this is, because, I mean, this includes, like, any sort of adverse personnel action that could disqualify them from receiving that position.
Under investigation.
Even under an applicant type scenario.
When you talk about, see, adverse personal action to me would be you know, that individual maybe has been put on leave without pay or leave with pay until it's cleared up. Not so much a letter of reprimand or anything that, I don't want to say a letter of reprimand is minor, but compared to being on administrative leave due to something else.
Okay. Maybe that's what, I mean, that's what y'all want to do is if they have some sort of investigation pending or adverse personnel action, but otherwise they're the best person for that position, y'all wouldn't be able to recommend them to the board.
Correct. Until it was cleared up. Yes, sir.
Okay.
So, I mean, I stepped out for a second, but that means that if the best qualified person for the job had something that they were in-house being looked at, or some incident happened, and they have not concluded or resolved the issue, that person could be excluded from the final decision if it were not cleared up before that decision was made.
Yes, sir. And that would be where we would have to, you know, we would know what that issue was. If the individual's been tardy three times compared to having maybe some other more serious charges against the individual, that would be a determination ultimately made by the superintendent, whether we would wait to fill it until it was clarified, or did we want to move on without that individual.
So, I mean, so that so that would leave it to a more subjective type of consideration.
In a way, I would respectfully disagree. I mean, we're playing games on what the charges are, but you know, if the charges are something that's going to take, as two attorneys can, however long it's going to take for something serious to get through, that would be one consideration compared to a allegation, and we're having to investigate, you know, if there was $55 missing from the deposit till that should have been in $55 more, and this teacher turned it in, which would be a little quicker for us to investigate. And that ultimately would be something that Ms. Tilly would make the recommendation on, yes, we're going to move forward and recommend someone else, or we're going to let this process work its way through before we fill this position.
Okay, but what if it was an investigation that's based on an allegation from another employee? Mm.
Like maybe like sexual harassment or something like that?
Yes.
Those would have to be investigated, and we would take the initial complaint seriously, go through the investigation. That is something that I feel that we could be able to complete within a 2 to 3 week time period.
I think I know where Ms.
Then would you postpone the assignment of that?
I would, if Ms. Tilly asked me to investigate the issue and it was time to make a recommendation, I would go to Ms. Tilly, this is what I've found so far, this is my recommendation to you, and Ms. Tilly would make this final determination whether we were going to wait until to completely get this thing over with before, if that was the individual that we wanted to make the recommendation on, then that's what we would do.
I think I know where Mr. Jerry's going with this. So let's say we had two, and this person's getting a promotion, and an employee has some kind of beef with this person getting this promotion, and she or he makes a complaint that they did something to he or she, then we decide, okay, we're not going to give that promotion to this person because we have an ongoing investigation of it. She or he may have done that on purpose so he didn't get the promotion.
And the other question I have in this, you know, what benefit does this have for y'all making a decision on personnel? Because the truth of the matter, I think, is, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that you have the decision anyway. So if there's something out there that you need to investigate or look into, do you want to be tied into this so that you can't hire this person, even if it is something like you said? I want to make sure that y'all understand that this.
I mean, it ties our hands.
It ties the administration's hand and the board's to not be able to make the decision you want to make. And if there are two, so if you have two people up for the same job, just like she's, like Ms. Abrams said, right, then do you want to have to look at what could be not real allegation. And we've, in the DSEG case, we've had many complaints that happened that are not desegregation related, but that happen, and then it could impede your ability to make a decision that you want to make, that is the best decision.
And then if we did do it, let's say Ms. Tilly decided to recommend somebody despite a pending investigation, but that was because she knew that it was a, you know, she knew what the outcome was going to be, but it hadn't been formally wrapped up. Well, then we open ourselves up to.
Then you're not following this policy.
Right. I would just strike the word investigation. I think the other portions, you know, if they're under suspension or they're on probation, you know, there's already been a finding and they need to finish out their probationary period before they get a promotion. But that those investigations have been completed and the consequences are in there. But I would strike the word investigation. So that'll make that in the form of a motion.
What do you think about, I think it's kind of vague, about or any other adverse personnel action? What does that mean?
My question, what do you think the benefit of having this sentence is at all?
I mean, if they're under suspension or probation, they're probably not getting a position anyway.
Right. I don't.
And Ron, you're the expert here. What do you think is the benefit of having this sentence? I really don't.
Particularly
the expert, and if you feel.
I'm the expert in that.
Because we're going to call you.
But this is not illegal to have this. No. This is, yeah. But it's a preference for how you administrate your school system, and that's a board and administration decision on. So legally, yeah, you can put this in here, but do you want to?
And then particularly also when it goes back to my first question about, we don't really do promotions anymore. If we have a vacancy, we advertise it. You have to apply. You're actually applying for a
position,
a new position. You're not getting a promotion. We don't. I don't know of any instance where we do a promotion.
That's correct. We advertise for it, and you go through the process.
So I guess, so, and that's the only thing you're proposing that we change is that one sentence. I guess we could just move to table it.
There's been a motion to table, which means there'll be no action taken on it. Do I need a second on that?
Mm-hmm.
I think I need a second.
Second
by Mr. Mingus. So we have to have a vote now on the motion to table.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section R, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBK, employee discipline.
The policy comes with just some additions of the Louisiana revised statutes that fall under the tenure teacher section and then an employee charged with a felony. And just some minor reorganizational and formatting.
Move to adopt.
Move to adopt by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Mr. Mingus. Any discussion? Call for vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams?
Ms. Abrams.
I'm trying to see if it'll take. Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Move to adopt.
We'll take a 2 to 4 minute break to allow her to catch up.
Channel 17, proudly serving the Florida parishes.
I will come back to order. Section S, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBL, tenure. Jinko.
Thank you, sir. It just talks about some related statutes that have been included in the reference section.
I'll make a motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Simmons, second by Mr. Mingus. Call for vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Abrams? Mr. Moore?
Yes.
It worked.
Yes. Section T.
What? Voting is closed.
Sorry.
Motion passes unanimously.
Ms. Sandra, can you hear me?
I can hear. Thank you.
Section T, consider approval of the revisions of policy GBM personnel transfer. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Section at the end of the first paragraph that's been added, about the best interest of the school system as determined by the superintendent, goes through a voluntary transfer. If I want to transfer from a X position to Y position, and talks about the HR responsibility of putting our vacancy announcements out there.
Hear a motion to approve?
I make a motion to approve.
Motion by Mr. Mingus.
Second question.
Second by Mr. Duncan.
Question?
Yes.
Mr. Jenko, so it says that they have to let us know by April the 1st if they want to transfer, but we don't have to let them know until May where there are positions available to transfer to.
So is
that how we want to do that?
Yes, sir. And what, in if 2021 is hopefully going to be fine where we can have our transfer fair, we'll have our transfer fair end of February, first part of March. So we'll have an idea of the individuals that want to transfer. After the transfer fair, then it's time for our principals to start having some conversations with their individuals that they hear in the lounge, maybe retiring and so forth. So that would give us some opportunity there to allow the transfers to happen and then fill any vacancies after that particular time.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
Any further discussion?
So are we, what happens if we have a, this is all volunteer transfers?
Yes, sir.
All about people volunteering to transfer, asking? Okay, all right.
Okay, call for the vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section U, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBNA, reduction of personnel.
Thank you, sir. There's a lot of policies that we don't want to stand up here and ever use, and hopefully this is one of them. But if we do, it just goes through the process of how those individuals will be identified, with starting with our teachers and so forth with the effectiveness rating. And then we go through for the individuals that are not evaluated on an effectiveness rating, how that would happen.
Your motion to adopt?
I'll make the motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Simmons.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. Any discussion? Call for a vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section V, consider approval of revisions to policy GBO, resignation. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Just a policy on its own that reminds employees if they choose to leave our employment, they need to let us know. We're going to ask for the reason why and the date that they need to be released.
Move to adopt.
Motion by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Ms. Simmons. Any discussion?
I'm sorry.
In the past, you had always asked them to fill out a survey, right? But they
Correct.
Didn't have
it's
to.
Survey.
But they didn't have to.
Correct.
But this is saying that they still don't have to.
This
right?
is saying, pretty please fill out the survey.
Yeah, I was going to say, it still doesn't say.
Okay. That's all this is. I mean, they're leaving us. It's like, what are you going to do? It's just, pretty please fill out the survey.
Well, it would be very beneficial if we would know why, especially if there's some issues that we need to address.
And in all fairness to the employees, when they're leaving for an issue, those individuals have no problem filling it out and letting us know what those issues are, for the most part.
Mr. Jenko, so what consequences to the employee who decides to resign if he doesn't agreed to fill out the...
If he doesn't let us know after 10 days, if he or she's not at work, we consider it job abandonment. And then we just put literally something in their file to let them know that, go through the process that they job abandonment and so forth.
Okay, so this is basically just your resignation letter that you
correct.
Asked.
You know, dear Ms. Stilley, I resign from Tangible Parish School System, gotcha. Effective whatever the date is, thank you, et cetera.
All right, okay.
If they don't put a reason in the resignation, there's nothing we can do to them. Right. That's what he's saying.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, you can't make them come back.
No. Okay. We're going to dock your pay.
On your next job.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section W, consider approval of revisions to policy GBQ, retirement.
Yes, sir. This is a happy time for some of the individuals' retirement, and they officially turn their paperwork in. And the one thing we have is that once they're received by the superintendent or designee, decision may only be rescinded by a written appeal to the superintendent. And that there are some other things that, you know, once it's a timing issue. If they receive that first retirement check and they cash it, then they cannot rescind their retirement. And that's all explained to them when they fill their paperwork out, either with us or at the retirement system.
Make a motion to accept.
Motion by Mr. Mingus.
I'll make a second.
Second by Ms. Abrams. Having discussion. Call for vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Go through, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section.
So this just came to me. So they could be 90 years old and still teach?
Yes, ma'am.
That's reassuring.
If they know how to do virtual teaching.
I mean, we had, I think it was last year or the year before, Ms. Myrtle Cook retired. I think that's 54 or 55 years of service with us. So
it's because of discrimination and all that. You can't discriminate.
Oh, no, ma'am. We do not.
That's why we let them go long. Right.
That's in one of our policies of yours. It's just pretty
can't. We want the best in the classroom, no matter the age.
Section Y, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRD, staff meet. Whoop, I think I skipped one. X, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRB, employee attendance.
Thank you, sir. Policy has been reorganized and some sections have been taken out. Information on summer work schedule, staff schedule, talks a little bit about tardiness and absences, and talks about unauthorized absences and so forth. A lot of green and red.
Hear a motion to adopt?
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Second. Duncan, second by Ms. Simmons. Having discussion. Call for vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Y, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRD staff meetings. Jinko.
Thank you, sir. It's just some language in there about regarding notice, giving faculty some advance notice on when meetings will be as much as possible, and that there should be a formal agenda for these particular meetings. And that will be given to the individual's immediate supervisor.
Where are you at?
Staff meetings.
So moved.
GBRD.
Motion by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Mr. Moore. Discussion.
Do we have restrictions on when these staff meetings can be called? Like time of day or like mornings?
No, sir. I'm hoping our principals are kind of polling their faculty. You know, if you have a bunch of early birds, they may want to get there earlier, a few minutes early to do it. I know most of them traditionally are after school.
Like if they want to call it on a Saturday or Sunday at 10 a.m., we can do that.
they would be filling out those exit surveys.
No.
We get a lot of exit surveys after.
They'd be happy to fill those out.
Call for the vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section Z. Consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRH, professional leaves.
Thank you. That includes information on district and state meetings that our employees are involved in. I know they've taken out some information on leave without pay because it's going to have its own particular section. And then talks about the professional development activities and when they get substitutes and how the individuals are paid for. And the school system gives, we call them pink forms, which allows the schools some professional development days that they can use, and the school system will pay for those subs.
Hear a motion to adopt?
Make a motion to adopt.
Motion by Mr. Mingus.
A second.
Second by Ms. Abrams. Discussion? Call for the vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Okay. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section AA, consider approval of revisions to policy GBRIA, general leave of absence. Mr. Jenko.
Yes, sir. It's a retitling of from general leaves of absences to personal leave. And as noted, information on the different types of leaves we have has been pulled out, and they'll have its own policy that will be coming up shortly.
Hear a motion to adopt?
I'll make the motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Simmons.
Second.
Second by Mr. Duncan. Any question?
Well, yes. What if something, well, I guess there's another section probably somewhere about emergencies, but what if they don't have 24 hours and something came up?
Right. Then that's quite all right. We would, okay. In a perfect world, we'd love 24 hours notice, but yeah. We know sometimes kids get sick over at 6 o'clock in the morning or things happen. Life happens.
Yeah.
Call for vote.
Voting is open. Mr.
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section BB, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRIB, sick leave. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. It has some cross references that it's made with some of our other policies so that they will be in line with each other, and that there are no significant changes to this policy with the exception of some of those cross references.
Make a motion to accept.
Motion by Mr. Mingus.
Second.
Second by Ms. Abrams. Any discussion? Call for vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes. Sorry.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section CC, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRIBA, sick leave bank. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Just some minor wording changes in a few of the titles, and changing from maybe school board from school district to school board.
Move to adopt.
Motion adopt by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Mr. Mingus. Any discussion? Call for vote.
Voting is open.
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section DD, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRIBB, family and medical leave. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Policy has been recoded from the GBRIBA and has added some definitions on the last, on the third and fourth page related to serious health issues and some for some clarification purposes.
Do I hear a motion? I'm sorry.
In section B, on the first page, number one, subparagraph B, we took that section out.
Because it does not comply with FMLA. So, but I think that you can, because this is just a grammar thing, or a style thing. Since we're taking B out,
A, moving into the sentence of number one.
You go
off.
I looked up
FMLA
and
can you roll it back down so I can see what they're talking about?
You can't have if two people work for the school system, you can't take away one of their leave, which is basically what this would do if we didn't take this out. They have to each be given the same amount of leave under FMLA.
Move to adopt.
Motion
with that grammatical adjustment.
So move A into the paragraph?
Into the sentence, yeah.
Motion been made to adopt.
Second.
Second by Ms. Abrams. Any discussion? Call for a vote.
Online voting is open.
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section EE, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRIC, maternity and adoptive leave. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Added a definition related to adoptive leave that the child must be under the 18 years of age and has some clarification of using of the sick leave shall be in accordance with policy and regulations applicable to its use.
So if you adopt an adult child, you don't get leave?
With over 18, you cannot.
You'll hear a motion to adopt?
I make a motion to accept.
Motion by Ms. Dominguez. There a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Duncan. Any questions? Call for vote.
Voting is open.
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section FF, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRID, military leave. Mr. Jenko.
It's just been updated. Forethought says they have not done anything with the policy since 2006. They just updated the policy to break out provisions with headings for clarity and to better address aspects of military leave.
Hear a motion to adopt.
Move to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Simmons.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez.
Any
discussion?
Thank you for their service. Thank you for their service.
Yep. Call for a vote.
Voting is open.
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section GG, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRIFA, emergency release time in case of employee death. Mr. Jenko.
Thank you, sir. Policy just goes through with a few minimal adjustments of the release time in case of the death of an employee with these particular sections.
Hear a motion to adopt?
Make the motion to adopt.
Motion by Ms. Simmons.
I second.
Second by Ms. Abrams. Any discussion?
Melissa, we all get to go to your funeral if you should pass away. According to this.
You get a day off. Call for the vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore.
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section HH, consider approval of revisions to policy GBRIH, jury duty.
Policy's been expanded to clarify the responsibilities of employees, such as the required return to work when released, provide the amount of remuneration received as to allow adjustment in the employee's salary. I've also included some provisions that delineate between subpoenas for school board business purposes and subpoenas for non-school board business or their personal business.
Hear a motion to adopt?
I make a motion to adopt.
Motion by Mr. Mingus.
Second.
Second by Mr. Duncan. Any discussion? Call for vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Okay. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Section II, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRJ, substitute personnel. Mr. Jenkins.
Thank you, sir. Just a minor change where they did a heading change from professional personnel to substitute teachers.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Duncan, second by Ms. Simmons. Any discussion? Call for the vote.
Voting is open.
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Sorry.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Last but not least, Section JJ, consider approval of the revisions to policy GBRK, annual leave.
Thank you, sir. I just made some verbiage changes to the payment, under the payment of unused annual leave, and some statutory references made to the current policy.
Hear a motion to adopt?
I make a motion to adopt.
Motion by Mr. Mingus.
A second.
Second by Ms. Abrams. Any discussion? Call for vote.
Voting is open. Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Nothing else to be brought before the Policy Committee of the Whole. It is adjourned.
It takes more than one person to assist in a personal injury claim. I am Attorney Glenn Westmoreland, and we have a strong team at the Mack Law Firm. It is our goal to make sure your injury is properly attended to. Contact me at tangylawteam.com and let us get you the help you need.